And that's where I want to start. Steph Curry, been almost 2 years since he's been in a playoff game, June of 2019. So he's been out of NBA fans' consciousness. And they're not thinking about Steph. He's not in the big playoff games. And didn't see him in the bubble. It was a year before. Where's Steph been? Oh, he came back last night. He was finally back on television. I don't know. Dominated the All-Star weekend. Won the three-point shooting contest and essentially decided the basketball game between the world's best players. Giannis wasn't the MVP. 13 of his 16 shots were like dunks and layups. Please. You know, 2 weeks ago, LeBron came out. He's like, yeah, Devin Booker is the most disrespected player in the game. Bruh, LeBron, I love you. Guys never won a playoff series. Come on, LeBron. Steph Curry, there's been this weird resentment around Steph Curry. You know, he grew up with money. You know, he's not a real, he's a little finessey. He's got a little shake, but he's not real physical. He doesn't dunk. And everybody loves these hyper-athletic point guards. Derrick Rose and John Wall and Russell Westbrook. They don't make anybody better and they can't shoot. How about a new rule on our show? If you're a 6'4 guard and can't shoot, go play football. I'm not interested in you. Devin Booker, he's not the most valuable guy on his own team. It's Chris Paul. Nobody would dispute he's great. But I've always thought it's really, Steph Curry's fascinating. We just forgot about him for 2 years. But when he won that unanimous MVP, the first ever, there was this weird resentment around him. Remember this couple years ago, guys were talking about their favorite players, and everybody's like, Westbrook, Westbrook, Westbrook. I'm like, can't shoot. It doesn't make anybody better. It doesn't make anybody better. Steph Curry shooting is better than anybody else in the world at anything they do in basketball. That's how good he is. Okay, think about this. Who are the three guards that are aging well? Dame, Steph Curry, and Chris Paul. Why? Two of them are great shooters. The third's a great leader and a good mid-range shooter. And there's always been this weird resentment about Steph. I mean, I think fans like him and kids love him. But the only thing he really stinks at is shoe design. Outside of that, he's the best shooter in the history of the world. He's the best ball handler I've ever seen. And he's probably the best superstar teammate. Oh, yeah, he's got three trophies. And none of those hyper-athletic guards that are on the cover of Slam magazine have any trophies. He's got three. One before KD, two after KD. And this year, with virtually no help, he's second best year ever, 30 points a game. But for some reason, when you start naming great players, I don't know what it is. He just gets left off. I mean, every time there's a list, it's Kawhi, it's Giannis, it's Embiid, it's KD, it's LeBron, all great players. And, Steph, well, he shoots. I don't know, it's crazy, but isn't that the league now? Well, you're not a great defensive player. Who is in the NBA not named Kawhi Leonard? I mean, seriously, who's a great... Harden plays no defense. Kyrie plays no defense. Luka plays no defense. Zion plays no defense. LeBron does what he's in the mood in June. So I thought it was great that the guy that was out of our consciousness for a couple of years comes back and takes over the weekend. He's probably the weakest all-star there. Probably has the smallest bench press. He doesn't really dunk, although he got one this weekend. I know he's kind of finesse. His shoes look like something a pharmacist would wear. Totally, I'm all in on all of that. But I love the fact that he dominated the weekend with the world's best basketball players, and I love LeBron James' tweet yesterday. Finally got to share the floor with Steph. Well overdue, loved every second. Greatest shooter all time. Changed how the game is played by himself alone. Respect beyond words. Thank you. Finally, the best player who gets it now gets it. Rick Bucher, Fox Sports NBA analyst, now is joining us, been covering the NBA for over 25 years. So, I mean, I couldn't have been happier that Steph Curry, who's been kind of out of our consciousness for a couple years, wasn't in the bubble, Golden State's in a rebuild when Klay got hurt, he shows up and basically owns the weekend. You've been covering this guy for years and years, and I've said before, is that whenever we start listing great players, it just always feels like Steph is just not quite put in that class. And I always argue he's the best shooter of my life. He's the best ball handler of my life. He's probably the lowest maintenance superstar of my life. And I just love the fact that he walked back into our consciousness and dominated the weekend. And I was like, yeah, that's who he is. Like, you've covered him. You ever surprised by stuff he does?
Oh, I'm surprised all the time. I mean, just his pregame routine and some of the places that he takes shots from just messing around. At the end, after the shot clock has gone off and he decides to flip the ball 40 feet in the air and it comes back down and hits nothing but net. I mean, that there's a subtlety to what makes Steph Curry special. He's not, even with the smaller guys like an Allen Iverson, just incredibly fast. There was just something, even a small dynamic about him. Steph's is all about the skill. There's still a subtlety to what he does. He doesn't look like he's dominating, and yet his skills and his abilities, he's Steve Nash supersized in terms of what he's able to do. Steve Nash was the same way. People didn't think he was athletic, and yet his hand-eye coordination, his shooting, his basketball IQ, those are all the things that Steph has. But I will say, you are overlooking that he had a pretty good cohort with him in Damian Lillard, who was basically doing the same thing. And I think this is also part of why there's pushback on Steph, because he's a good guy, because he's an entertainer, because there's just a unique joy about how he plays the game, that he gets a lot of attention. And people are like, whoa, 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 does he really deserve all of that attention? And if I'm in the Damian Lillard camp, and I'm not in either one, I would be saying, hey, look, Damian Lillard closed the game. Damian Lillard shot 8-for-16. Damian Lillard outscored Steph, and yet what I'm hearing on shows like Colin Cowherd's today is that this was the Steph Curry show. Like, what can we get just a little bit of balance here? It's either you don't think he's a superstar or you think he's the greatest thing that's ever happened to basketball.
I like Dame. I don't want to be a Dame hater. Blake Griffin with the Nets. First of all,
speaking of guys that you're hating on,
I'm not a Blake Griffin guy. He's a great athlete. I was always a Chris Paul over Blake Griffin with the Clippers. I would argue with my friends all the time. I'm like, one's a winning basketball player, one's a great athlete. There's a massive difference. One's a top five point guard ever. One's a wing guy that I still don't trust to hit a big shot or a big free throw in a big game. I'm not denying his talent. He went to Detroit. He was never healthy. Couldn't elevate him to a playoff win. I mean, what is he for Brooklyn?
Okay. First of all, he was never healthy in Detroit. He dragged them into the playoffs. And yes, they got swept in the first round by Milwaukee, but that was probably as competitive a series as you could have for a sweep. And Blake was not healthy. I think what he demonstrated there, first of all, you go from LA to Detroit and you do it happily and you embrace the challenge and you drag he's basically sacrificed his body in Detroit to get them to the postseason. And there's plenty of guys who go, why would I possibly do that just to get Detroit to the playoffs? So I'm not going to knock him on that. The fact of the matter is he is no longer an athlete, not in the sense that you're talking about. His strengths are that range and being able to shoot. Still his strength in terms of being able to defend bigger players and then take them out to the perimeter at the other end. Passing has always been underrated, and his basketball IQ. And maybe this is wishful thinking on my part, but I believe that he's going to get a chance to demonstrate those other elements. I've compared him to Jason Kidd, not the first Dallas iteration, but the second Dallas iteration, when he went back and he was no longer an athlete. He was an orchestrator. He was a three-point shooter. That's kind of the mode that Blake Griffin is in now. And I would expect that he's going to play the five in their small ball lineup. It'll be Jeff Green and Blake Griffin holding that down. Is he better than Jeff Green at this point? I don't know. Possibly not. Can he give them some moments, some games in the postseason? I believe that's what they're counting on. But I've been told by people inside the organization, he is going to play. This isn't just a vanity addition of a big name, that they are genuinely hoping that he is going to be able to contribute.
So LeBron, the second chapter on LeBron's legacy, the first chapter, he's great. Second chapter is he just plays forever. He never gets hurt and he plays.
Right.
But he played 13 minutes in the All-Star game. He took a game off a couple nights ago. He does look a little weathered, and LeBron would never state this. It's not his thing. Right. He always says the right thing. But I go back to it. Once again, this was going to be Anthony Davis's year. It does look like at times LeBron realizes he's not 27 anymore, right?
Yeah. No, 100%. I mean, he's been trying to manage his energy throughout this season so far, and the plan was never for him to play as many minutes or not to take any games off sooner than he did. It was simply they had no choice. It was by necessity because AD's been out, Dennis Schroeder was out, and they did have to maintain some sort of rhythm and winning a few games here and there. The All-Star game to me was where LeBron's age became more evident than ever, just in comparison to everybody else. And yeah, we got a couple of have him hitting a couple dunks, and he's shrewd and he's smart. He knew a way to kind of look like he was part of it. But I think one of the reasons why he benched himself was because you got these guys just firing threes from everywhere. He's a confident shooter when it comes to three. He missed his first one or two, and he's like, okay, this ain't my day there. And then you got Giannis just crushing everything on the inside. He's like, yeah, not like that. And I don't want to look like Domantas Sabonis, who looks completely like a fish out of water in this game. So you know what? Let me get a dunk or two, and then I'm just going to let my team roll, and I'll save my energy for the end of the season. But the difference in athleticism between LeBron and the rest of those young guns and the way the game is played now, what makes it exciting, which is the three-point shot, it was as definitive and as stark as I've seen. I think he's done a good job of hiding it or minimizing it up to this point. But the All-Star game was like, wow, these guys are 6, 7, 8 years younger than he is, or they have a skill set that's more attuned to the way the game is being played right now.
Yeah. Finally, I think the All-Star game, I think they did a good job on it. I think the Pro Bowl's unwatchable. I actually like the dunk contest was kind of quirky, but overall, I thought it was a pretty good, I sat and watched it for a couple hours. I like the thing they do at the end of the game where they have a score target and they just, you hit 170. Okay, game's over. Let's go home. I kind of like it. They got a bunch of quirky stuff. I think it works. I mean, it's an All-Star game. It doesn't count, so let's make it a little quirky. What's your takeaway on the whole event?
Yeah, look, I like the quarter by quarter. I think it maintains a certain competitive edge. The adding 24 at the end makes it interesting. I mean, the bottom line is that the All-Star weekend to me was reflective of where the game has gone, and that it was all about three-point shooting. More than 60% of the shots in the game were three-pointers. Giannis didn't miss a shot, and yet it was all Steph Curry and Damian Lillard and who's going to knock down the next three from 45 feet. They've added elements to the three-point shooting contest. The three-point shooting contest was far and away the most entertaining and competitive event of the weekend. Now, my question is that, is this going to be what wins the championship this year? Is it going to be three-point shooting? Is it going to be three-point shooting from 35 feet? Like, generally, it goes back to defense. It goes back to principles. But this has been a weird year, and I just wonder whether this is a reflection. The All-Star game and All-Star weekend is a reflection that the NBA is pivoting toward, we're just going to run up and down, and we're going to be hoisting 30-footers. And whoever makes the most 30-footers wins. Because this is the other part with Steph in his rise, is that the game is not physical at all anymore. When I got guys begging for foul calls in the All-Star game, I know that this league has gotten incredibly soft.
Rick Bucher joining us. Good talking to you, bud. Thanks.